So. So. Good afternoon. Today's concluding lecture of our semester. So, conic programming is challenging and very important. It's like a little bit different from the all other parts of course. It's more mathematical, but it give you very nice background for many stuff. Not only conic programming itself, but mathematical issues that we touch here are very important. And we talk about possible examples of conic programming, and of course in this lecture you will see more examples. So you learned the Chebyshev approximation in real numbers in previous lecture. And here I didn't give you home because it's a little bit technical. Chebyshev approximation of functions, of complex functions. But you should be aware that this is conic quadratic programming, and if you are interested, this is very important application. Okay, only one word. And then you move to applications of semi-definite programming, and a lot of problems which doesn't look as semi-definite programming are really converted to it using the lemma of Schur complement. And I remind you what it says. If I have a square symmetric matrix, which is built of blocks, so P and R are symmetric matrices, and Q maybe even rectangular, because P and R may be on different sides. And those two are squares. And we say that if you know that R is positive definite, then all matrix A is positive, say, definite, if and only if this expression is positive definite, and the same of semi-definite. And there was a hint to the proof in the lecture. And now in the class we will try to accomplish the proof, put it really in our head. So the idea of proof is, was the following. If our matrix consists of blocks, then it's a reasonable also vector, which we multiply by this matrix also to split into corresponding parts, two blocks, U and V. And we say the matrix is positive definite if for any U and V this product is non-negative. And now we say interesting thing, let's minimize this expression in V. If we are able to minimize it in V, if it is non-negative, then also minimum in V should be non-negative. And immediately if we minimize in V, we are left only with expression which depends on U. So if for any U this should be non-negative, then this matrix will be non-negative. So this is our first class exercise. Let's try to show that minimum in V of this expression is given here. So what we should do, we should think of U as constant and express everything as quadratic function of V, compute its gradient with respect to V, equate it to zero, and see that we get to this condition. Okay. Have not much work in the beginning. You can start warm up with this problem, and then we go forward. Stop. those who don't know how to start, how do we multiply block matrix by a vector? It's like thinking of the same rule as if here were numbers and here also numbers. So it's first row, yes, this multiplied by u plus this multiplied by v will be the first element of result. And to keep in memory this matrix. So this should be square, and this may be a rectangle, the same as this. I just start to make your life easier, yes? I show you how, what is the product, yes? Of this matrix by block vector. It will give you stuff. It will relax your brakes, in the inner brakes. Ah, sorry. Thank you. Row by, yes. If somebody feels lonely and difficult to advance, I would recommend even to sit maybe in pairs, more close to somebody who is working. Sometimes it helps. And those who know to advance, please help your friends to join the process. You can please change your it's difficult. Just if it is possible. Just let it will be easier. I should introduce you. Please sit close to each other. If it's difficult for you to work, just discuss and talk and. You did it?
Sehr gut sein.
And raise your hand who did it. Who wants to show? Okay, let's do advantage of those who did it less. Okay. Maybe here.
By we take u transpose v transpose, that's our vector this is multiplied by this, and this is multiplied by this. So E equals to U transpose EU plus U transpose U transpose V plus same row V transpose U V and U U and V transpose R V. Now this and this, since this is not symmetric, Q should be symmetric too.
No, just a second. Q is not symmetric. Pay attention. Pictured it rectangular. So it cannot be symmetric.
Okay. Yes, okay. But so Q is not symmetric, but these two are scalars. Therefore, their transpose is equivalent.
Those two expressions are the same.
Yes, okay.
Are numbers.
Yes, correct. Yes, these are scalars.
Those are scalars, so we can take transpose and
exactly.
Show that they are
so this
the same.
Is equal to V transpose RV plus twice U transpose Q transpose V plus U transpose V U. From here, this is the regular quadratic equation we all know. We can derive it, we get
function. Quadratic function.
Function, yes. So to get the infimum of this over V, we can derive it by V.
Compute gradient with respect to V, yes. Derive and compute derivative, it's not the same in English.
We can compute the gradient with respect to V.
Yes.
We get twice RV plus this is twice U transpose it. Q transpose.
Just a second. This is gradient with respect to V?
Yes,
this.
So it's transpose of
this
expression.
This is the gradient transpose.
Yes.
So now we want this to be equal to zero.
The V is transpose.
And the third term doesn't depend on V, yes?
Yes, this is a constant. The V here is not transposed. This should be a column vector. So if this is equal to zero, we get our optimal V to be minus R inverse Q U. So now we plug this back into here, and we get the exact Should I write it, or?
Should it be written, or? No. I ask you. It's enough. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Good. Now we are a little bit used to Schur-Koplinger limit. Okay. Let's continue. Okay, now we make a little shift of gears and move to the problem which was in the lecture. I have a matrix which depends on X, maybe in affine manner. And I want to find such a X which minimizes maximal eigenvalue. So I have this matrix A of X, which is written here, and I want to minimize the maximal eigenvalue of A. So you saw in the lecture the development, but let me stress on some small points. It shows the basic thing that almost everybody knows. So if my matrix A has eigenvalues lambda, so it's the entries of this diagonal matrix. Can we show that A plus something multiplied by identity matrix? This is very basic and rather simple. Has eigenvalues lambda. lambda plus ti. That shows us. It's simple. It comes from definition. You can start AV is lambda V, definition of eigenvector and eigenvalue. Mm-hmm. And try to see what will be eigenvalue of A plus TI. It's simple. Just try to write it down. What is A plus TI multiplied by V? And we will be ready just to show us. It's simple, but it's very important to remember about this. So A plus TI multiplied by
something.
Just two lines, I believe. Who did it? It's simple, but very important to know and to remember.
Let's assume we have a vector of A, so AV equal lambda V.
Yes.
Now we show that this V is also a vector of A plus TI.
Yes. Use something different? You say this is should be lambda V. Sorry. You opened the parenthesis. You should not only to write but also to comment. So you open a parenthesis. You open a parenthesis and you say that A V actually is lambda V.
And
I V
it's V.
Yes.
So it's T V. V from both sides, you get that the eigenvalue is lambda plus T, as we said here.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. So, again, we get to conclusion that multiply this matrix by V is like multiplying this number by V. So, by definition, this is eigenvalue of this matrix. Okay. And now of course, eigenvalues of minus A, the minus eigenvalue of A can be shown in the same way. And so, instead of this problem, we look on such problem. Minimize a scalar, such that scalar greater than maximal eigenvalue. If it's greater than maximum eigenvalue, it should be greater than all eigenvalues. And what we say after this? So if I build a diagonal matrix such that T is that this difference is positive, yes, is non-negative.
For every eigenvalue?
For every lambda I. Yes, this is what I written. It's the same like to say that eigenvalues of this matrix should be non-negative. Or in other words, this matrix should be positive semidefinite. So this was our way to describe the problem. So we wanted to minimize t such that t greater than every eigenvalue of A, and conclude that we minimize t that this matrix is positive semidefinite. We showed that this is equivalent. And this is semidefinite programming. So this problem, actually what is interesting, this problem was considered as extremely difficult before semidefinite programming came in the, it's relatively recently, it's in 90s of 20th century, it's like how many years ago, say 25 years ago, 30 years ago. Before then, 30 years ago, people didn't know how to treat these problems efficiently. And now we know, and in many applications, one of them is optimal control or stability of systems is related to maximal eigenvalue of system matrix. For example, it's like one of the examples. Okay, any question, any comment about this problem? And now we move to a little bit similar problem, but still different. It's a linear matrix approximation. Assume that we are given matrix A naught, and what to approximate is weighted sum of other given matrices. So X is our variable of choice. So we want to find such X's that this sum will be as close as possible to A naught, but in which sense? The residual matrix called A of X. We have minimal operator now. If you would say that it's a minimal sum of squares of elements, it's a very easy problem. It's easy to solve. But quite often we have some elementary blocks and we want to approximate given operator, given complicated linear function in some systems. Yes? But we want that what we imitate will be as close to original in operator now. And this is a problem we try to solve. So we want to minimize operator norm of residual. And what is operator norm of matrix? If I consider AU for all vectors inside of unit ball, say 2 norm of U less or equal 1. So operator norm of A is maximal over all possible U's of this expression. Let us first of all try to show very basic fact that operator norm of A is the maximum eigenvalue of A transpose A. So, let's start. This will be our next slide. Next task. So, to show that the operator norm of A it's easier for me to put square here is lambda max of A transpose A. Let's try to show this step by step. And how we will start. How start. We should put the expression for this, yes? What we say is the operator norm, it's this one. If you put square, it's maximum in U, U transpose, A transpose, AU. Maximal norm of U less equal 1. We can denote, we can consider this is some symmetric and positive definite metric, this product. And assume that it has eigenvalue decomposition. I just want to put you on the right track.
If you want a very short solution to this problem.
Okay, we will consider. Let's go in this way, and then can consider what you propose. So I say that this is has eigenvalued decomposition. Say this is S lambda S transpose. And S is orthogonal matrix. And now I have this expression that U transpose S lambda S transpose U. I just open parentheses and substitute. And this I can denote as some other vector V. For example, V transpose, and this will be V. Okay. From this point, I want to let you go alone, and just to remind, if I multiply a vector by orthogonal matrix, it doesn't change its norm. So if I have restriction on norm of U, then the same restriction is on norm of V. And now my optimization problem is simple. I want to maximize in V. Maximize in V V transpose lambda V. Let me leave you with this challenge and try to show that this maximum is just lambda is diagonal matrix. It's just maximal eigenvalue of lambda. So this was our goal, yes? Our goal was to show that operator norm of A squared is just maximum eigenvalue of A transpose. I will leave you at this point and see whether anybody will be able to manage it.
I know that A transpose A is positive semi-definite because it's a Gaussian matrix. And so all the, and those are the eigenvalues of A transpose A. Because it is semi-positive definite, all the eigenvalues are greater or equal to zero. And we know that this matrix has the eigenvalues on the diagonal, and they are sorted from largest to smallest.
Yeah.
And so I just pick V equals 1 and zeros, and if I look at this expression, I get 1 and zeros multiplied by a matrix of lambda max
show that for every other vector I get a smaller expression. Mm-hmm. It is very simple to see that because I need the norm to be smaller or equal to 1, if I replace this expression, this 1, and like divide it over other parts, mm-hmm. I would get that this equals to alpha lambda max, alpha 1, plus alpha 2 lambda, let's call it 2, and that's a weighted sum till alpha n lambda n, hope you can see. And if I replace all of these lambdas just by lambda max, I get, and I know the weighted sum is equal to 1.
Sum of alpha I is 1, yes?
Alpha I is 1. So I know this expression is smaller or equal, if all the lambdas are equal, to replacing all of the lambdas by lambda max. To sum alpha I lambda max equals 2 lambda max. And that's it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, so it's a very important knowledge. Then that operator norm is maximal eigenvalue of A transpose A. So our goal was to find such Ax that the difference will be as small as possible. So we want to minimize maximal eigenvalue of this expression. And we already have this problem with minimizing maximal eigenvalue previous part. So to minimize maximal eigenvalue, we could write minimize some parameter. Say t squared, it doesn't matter. It was tau, now instead of tau we have t squared. Subject 2, this difference is positive semidefinite. If you don't write square, it's the same as minimize t itself, but we have additional constraint. T is equal. But now, we say that if you go and see for good efficient solvers for semi-definite programming, we see that those solvers like to solve the problems where objective function and constraints are linear in our original variables. And here we have like quadratic term. And the claim is that to have this positive semi-definite, it's the same like have this matrix, which linearly depends on X, positive semi-definite, and the equivalence can be shown with the Schur complement lemma. And I invite you to try to show using Schur complement lemma that those two actually are equivalent. And this is our next class exercise, and I will put on the Schur complement lemma maybe on one more screen. We have it in front of our eyes. Let's try to combine two windows on one screen. Wait a second. Here is lemma of Schur complement. Okay, so this is our challenge. So this is what lemma says, that this matrix to be positive semi-definite is the same as this expression. could be positive, semi-definite. So try to connect those two. Yes, what was the question? Or now?
Okay.
The challenge is more clear. I hope the camera catches now the doorstep. Okay. So now you should put everything into your brain to try to get the connection between those two. Move it a little bit. Oops, sorry. Move it a little bit.
Keep on. Just a little bit left more.
Just a second. Yes, what was the question? Yes? So this is our R, and inverse just 1 over T somewhere. What is inverse of TI?
1 over T
times
I.
1 over T multiplied by I. Okay, who? Who did it? Okay, let's wait for 1 more minute.
Yeah.
Other people try. Once again, who did? But you already showed us, yes. Who didn't show yet today? Okay. Everything.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have the our matrix, and we apply the Shor component lemma to it, and we get from this matrix we should get the similar result to that one. So it will be.
This one should be good.
So we get Ti minus A transpose X Ti minus 1. A from X should be positive, yeah.
And but basically we have one more requirement, yes? R should be
positive
definite. What does it mean for us?
It means that T should be bigger than zero.
Okay, you can write it.
Yeah. T should be bigger than zero. Okay, so from this we get Ti. This one is equals 1 divided by t multiplied by I, and we can drop I and move t to the side because it's the constant. And from this we multiply it by t and we get d squared I minus a transpose a equal to 0. Okay. So this is basically the same thing that we have as.
Okay. Now, maybe after. Actually, we have a lot of material today. Maybe it's good for us to stay, make a break. Now it's good to make break, not to start something for 3 minutes, and we will continue. Okay. So now you will touch a little bit the connection of other problems to semi-definite programming. One trivial example is that linear programming can be casted as semi-definite. One just matrix which should be positive semi-definite is diagonal, so if we have a system of linear inequalities that should be satisfied, we put them as elements of diagonal matrix and say that this matrix should be positive semi-definite. So it's rather trivial. And a little less trivial example is conic quadratic programming, which was in the class, in the video lecture, and then let's repeat it for ourselves. So we have a quadratic conic problem. So what is Lorentz cone? We have a vector u and scalar v, and say that norm of u greater or equal than, less or equal. Less or equal than scalar v. And if u and v, if depending on our variables x in affine way, so we have that ax minus b, some affine function which we call u, is less or equal, norm 2 of this expression, less or equal than this scalar expression, e transpose x plus d. And let's try to show that this constraint is actually equivalent to this one. Temporarily hide this to let you make your challenge by yourself. So just try to show that saying this, what is written here, is saying that two norm of u is less or equal b. Yes? To say that this matrix is positive definite is to say that u that you move all the stuff. It's the same as to say that two norm of u is less equal b. B is a scalar. Again, you can think this is an identity matrix multiplied by b. It will be easier. And then your sure complement lemma.
Can I ask a question? In the matrix, the diagonal is v, or only the first element is v and the other is ones? Because if you use ones, it is
v. No, this should be v. Everything should be v. Okay. But v is a scalar. So it's like identity matrix multiplied by scalar v.
We just can use the shore for this matrix. We'll write V minus U transpose. This component is like V multiplied by the identity matrix. Okay, U. And it should be greater than 0, and we have to.
Should be inverse somewhere.
Yeah, this. This is inverse, like we saw in the previous exercise.
Yes,
it's pretty
yes.
The same. And we have to demand that v will be bigger than 0 in order it to be positive definite, something R is positive definite. Yeah. So this is the same. V. Okay, so V is positive, we can transpose it. Change the sign, okay? And this is going to be okay. So we want this in that side. Okay, it doesn't really matter. Transpose u, and we can multiply by v, so it's v squared, and just and then we can take a root of the both sides. With v, this is the same second norm.
Okay, so you get used to this relatively simple examples to show complement. Yes, what is the question?
You can refer to the seven different large and equal as like it's usual, like it's normal larger equal because here.
I remind the basic things. This curve larger than equal says that matrix is positive semi-definite. If without curved, usually, I don't know, it depends on conventions.
But here
sometimes
like,
people mean the same, sometimes people say that elements should be non-negative.
But here you refer it's the same, like bigger.
Okay, it's a good question, because here are scalars.
Okay.
Here u transpose u. Is of size of 1.
So
for scalar as matrix 1 by 1 to be positive semi-definite is the same as to be greater than 0.
You can also say that it's conic programming, so I say they belong to the cone.
Yes.
So I can write like the exactly the same, but I can transfer a theorem of the
Yes.
Because I say that this expression just means that this coil minus U transpose U is belong to the cone of positive definite element.
Yes. Okay. So now the last remaining topic, let's see what do we have here. Yes, how to solve numerically conic programming problems. And the easiest thing is to write down barrier or penalty function method and minimize it with the methods we already know, with the Newton method or quasi-Newton. Usually, good theory is developed for minimization of baryon methods with Newton method, and it works well for moderate size of problems, for with thousand, few thousand of variables, or maybe for very large problems when the Hessian matrix, which will be in the Newton, has some special structures, sparse or some other good properties, which allows to solve it fast. But first, let's see. So we say that if we have a constraint and some function of x belongs to cone, so we build a barrier which goes to infinity when we approach the boundary of cone from inside. Despite that there are penalty methods which as you are used in usual nonlinear programming, there may be penalty which is defined everywhere, just increases outside of cone. But barrier are rather popular in conic programming. And here are examples, basic examples of barrier. If you have non-negative artant, this is the usual logarithmic barrier function which we mentioned in nonlinear optimization. If we have a quadratic conic constraints, so what is quadratic conic constraint? The norm of all elements of U except of, say, last one is smaller than the last one. So this expression should be positive. So if you take log of it, it forces it to be positive. And interestingly, this function is convex. It's not obvious from the first look, because you have one part is positive under log and other negative, but still it's a convex function. And the most interesting is for positive semi-definite matrices. It's logarithm of determinant of matrix.
Isn't that very expensive?
To compute determinant, it's like do matrix factorization. Because if we factorize matrix in lower and upper triangle, then determinant is just product of elements. So it's not very expensive, but it works for reasonable matrices of few thousands. It's challenging or larger. But this is very interesting function. It gives us an excuse to learn a bit about matrix functions, which is important issue itself, much out of semi-definite programming. So, what is the determinant of A? If I have eigenvalue decomposition of A, I know the property of determinants. The determinant of product of matrices is product of determinants. This is one property. And another, that determinant of inverse matrix is 1 over determinant of the original. So we have determinant of S canceling with determinant of inverse. We leave with determinant of lambda eigenvalue matrix, so we get the determinant of matrix is just product of eigenvalues, which is very nice to know. And if you have a logarithm of this, you have logarithm of products or sum of logarithms. And actually what I didn't is not written on this. I hope it is written in the video, which actually sum of what is, we have sum of log of lambda I is trace of log of lambda, yes? Yes. Can we show that it is also trace of log of A? I want to have it as trace, sorry, here is U, trace of log of U. Can we show this? That's the one more small exercise, because we know formula for eigenvalue decomposition of trace, and okay, let's postpone it here.
You showed in the video the trace of some function of the matrix.
If A, some matrix A is log of U, yes? Is trace A, and A is, I don't know, V lambda V inverse. Can I show the trace of A is trace of lambda?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, because I have trace of A is trace of V lambda V inverse, and we know that under trace we can permute in circular order. So it's trace V inverse lambda. V inverse V lambda. And of course this cancels. So I get trace lambda. So you see this intimate connection, which we will see in the minute. Okay. Yes.
צעד כלשהו שבמהלכו שני ערכים עצמאים משנים סימן הופכים לשליליים, אנחנו עדיין כאילו יצאנו מהתחום, אבל הפונקציית דריאר שלנו לא תשים לב לזה.
You say that it may be a little bit challenging for optimization method if it cuts out of the area, then determinant will be preserved. So the methods should take special care not to break out of area, not to cross the barrier itself. And this is like internal part of this Newton method, which there are guarantees that if your step size is a little bit smaller than identity Newton step, you are guaranteed to stay inside of the visible area. Yes, thank you for your presentation. Okay. Okay, and now we will touch a little bit matrix functions, because actually we will see what we really want, that to have this here logarithm of matrix as a matrix function, and then to know the goal, if we even want to use gradient descent or quasi-Newton method. We should be able to compute gradient of this expression. And this is a little bit challenging, and this this you had in the video lecture. So, what we told that, first of all, if I have a function of scalar variable, and I have a Taylor expansion, then if I substitute matrix into this Taylor expansion, I have the same. So, what people classically know, they know matrix exponents, because they are widely used in differential equations. But you can also take sinus of matrix or logarithm of matrix in the same formal way. Just write down Taylor expansion for your function and substitute the matrix. But if I have eigenvalue decomposition of my matrix, then all powers of A are very easily expressed. So if I take if A, if I have just a second, yes, if I have eigenvalue decomposition of my matrix A, then A square is very easy because you have cancelled S and S in inverse. Just in eigenvalue decomposition of A, keep the same eigenvectors and just take square of eigenvalues. And the same is for any degree. So if I substitute Taylor expansion, if I make Taylor expansion of A, it's the same that for every entry of eigenvalue matrix, to have the same Taylor expansion. So finally, it's interesting to take sinus A, I just need to take sinus of diagonal of eigenvalues and keep the same eigenvectors. So this is a nice thing. And what will be logarithm of A? It's again to take logarithm. And what is will be a trace of logarithm of A? Sum of logarithm of eigenvalues. So now we understand what I tried to write you here. Yes, that sum of logarithms of eigenvalue of my matrix is just trace. Yes. Finally, what we have. Do I have it in my slides? I don't have it yet, but let me write it down here.
It's
from
the line.
I do. Do I have it?
No. There is
a
substantial function of the function of the matrix.
Trace of P of A.
So, but I want to write it explicitly. Sum of log of lambda I, which will be my barrier for semi-different programming, is trace of log of my matrix, which was U in that case. Minus, if there was minus. So this is nice form, because then I can ask about properties of such a function, trace of some function of matrix. And especially I want to develop gradient of trace. And how I develop gradient of trace? Yes?
Not in a Taylor expansion way. What is the definition of log of a matrix? What am I supposed to get? A matrix that multiplied by itself?
Element wise?
So you have two definitions. You can take Taylor expansion of log and substitute matrix instead of scalar variable.
Yes, but
and technically you can do eigenvalue decomposition of your matrix and take log of eigenvalues.
Yes, but
and keep eigenvectors the same.
But what is the definition of log of a matrix not in a Taylor expansion way? I have a function and I just want to calculate.
Well, what is sinus of matrix? I have
it's the exact same question.
Matrix A, which is S lambda S inverse. What is sinus A?
I don't know.
And I can give you two definitions which coincide one with the other. Or take sum of CI A to the power I, where CI you took from Taylor expansion of sinus. Or equivalent is just S sinus lambda S inverse, where sinus lambda is element wise.
Oh, okay. But
so it's if you are still not satisfied,
yes,
you want
I'm not satisfied.
Something more.
Let's just say I take a log of
Let's be with sinus because we also already wrote sinus.
But sinus, I cannot explain the question.
Huh?
If I take log like of 2, log base 2 of matrix U, does that mean that the matrix I get, if I multiply it by itself, I get U? Not U, the matrix U.
You mean not multiply, you take exponent or
yes,
something
exponent.
Like this?
Yes, yes, exponent. I multiply it by itself, exponent.
No.
Take to the power. If you take matrix exponent of this, it should return. Yes.
Then what is the definition of taking an exponent of a matrix? Doesn't it multiply it by itself?
No. Exponent of the matrix, again, take a Taylor expansion of exponent, or take exponents. So you should you want me to put here x because people more used to it.
אני חושב שרוצה לדעת אם יש איזושהי הגדרה שלא קשורה לטור טיילור.
כן, ההגדרה מתמטית גיאומטרית.
לא, אין.
שניהם מתוך טור טיילור.
Two definitions which coincide. Sometimes they are delicate. Question. Sometimes my function may not have a converging Taylor expansion everywhere, and I may stay with this definition, say this is more general definition than this one.
So the definition is based on the Taylor expansion. It cannot exist without the Taylor expansion.
I take freedom. For my... let's consider the situation when they coincide, when Taylor expansion converges to our function.
Okay.
Interesting for us, yes. Because if they don't coincide, things need special treatment. Okay, so assume that they coincide, and I ask, so I have this, I have trace of phi of A, and I want to ask what is gradient with respect to A. Gradient of, so this is scalar function of a matrix. Trace of matrix function, scalar function of a matrix. And in the lecture, we develop it for example, say, t to the power 3, t cubed. And we show that if our function of A is trace of A by A by A. We can, if I do some differential, put some differential on A and ask what is differential of this expression. So we have already these rules that I put dA at first place and consider in other places as constant, and then to the second, and then to the third, and sum they up. and use it under trace. I can do rotational shift of multiplication and get this very simple formula that finally gradient gradient will be 3a squared transpose. And if I ask for my scalar function t cube, what is its derivative? It's 3t squared. So I just take derivative of my function and apply it to my matrix A and take the transpose. So this is very nice and easy rule. And now we are ready to compute gradient of logarithm of determinant. Looks terrifying, yes? Gradient of logarithm of determinant. If you get inside of determinant and start manipulating, you will be in very difficult technical work. But if you just apply this formula, so we know that the derivative of logarithm, if I have logarithm of t, the derivative is 1 over t. So, and I immediately say that gradient with respect to a is just a inverse. And we have logarithm.
And that is, again, that's very, very expensive to compute.
A inverse?
Yes.
Okay, in Newton. It's a little bit maybe expensive. So semi-definite programming often it's not very cheap, but still it's doable if you have a thousand or few thousands of variables. It's challenging to go with semi-definite programming to 100,000 and so on, only when you have very special property in A that inverse is easily computed. Okay, and this is more or less, you had one more part in the lecture, because actually we have an expression that we have A of X, and we have this function, say, trace phi of A of X. A is expressed as some linear operator multiplied by x plus some constant phi. We will discover that a joint operator will be part of expression for gradient, and there are some special cases when you can compute adjoint operators. We can leave this open. I have only to let you know. Who is interested? I have a slide on Hessian. It is not in video, but if you are interested, this can be discussed at some point. Okay, this is very briefly we finished what is semi-definite programming. It's a very large topic, and only small touch we got to it. And this is the end of our course. Thank you for and yeah, you have a question.
Can you talk a little bit about the test?
About what?
The test.
Ah, exam.
Exam, yes.
Okay, indeed.